All right, we're going to drill down and talk about a specific reinforcement learning algorithm in just a moment. But I wanted to remind everybody about some of the quantities that Charles introduced in the lesson last time when he's talking about MDPs and use them to describe three different approaches for solving reinforcement learning problems. So this first box here, pi, maps states to actions. And what did you call this, Charles?
A policy.
That's right. And reinforcement learning algorithms that work directly on trying to find the policy are called policy search algorithms. So the good thing about policy search is you're learning the quantity that you directly need to use, right? You're learning the policy. That's supposed to be the output. So that seems like a really good thing. Unfortunately, learning this function is very indirect. We don't get direct access to, I was in this state, what action should I have chosen, right? So this is, what did you call this, Charles? The temporal credit assignment problem, right? So the data doesn't tell you what action to actually choose.
Right, and this is why it's not exactly like the way we've formulated supervised learning in the past.
Well, at least if we're trying to do policy search, that's right. But what we're going to do is now consider, well, maybe that's not the quantity that we want to learn. Let's think about learning this function u, which you had said maps states to values. So what was this guy?
U is a utility.
Yeah,
the true utility of the state. Sometimes I think I called it the value of the state.
Yeah, so sometimes it's referred to as a value function, and learning methods, reinforcement learning methods that target that as what they're trying to learn directly are called value function based approaches.
Mm-hmm.
And let's say that we try to learn this, we're trying to learn to map states to values. Well, the good news is, at least if we're acting in the world, we're getting to see, okay, I was in some state, I took some action, and I can observe the values that actually result from that, and maybe use that to make updates. So you can kind of imagine learning this, so the learning's not quite as indirect. How do we use this to decide how to behave? So we need to turn it into a policy.
Mm-hmm.
And we sort of talked about how to do that in terms of looking at the Bellman equations. Turns out it's actually kind of hard to use u directly to do that. But we're going to talk about a different form of the value function that's going to make that easy. So this is actually, it turns out it'll be a relatively easy kind of argmax operation once we have the right kind of value function.
Okay.
So there's some computation we have to do, and there's some indirectness to the learning, but, you know, it's okay. All right, so the other quantities that you told us about were t, which is, I think of it as the transition function. I think you had a different name for it.
I just called it the transition model.
The model, right. Yeah, so this is the model, and the r is the reinforcement function, the reward function.
Mm-hmm.
And what do these things do? They take states and actions, and the transition function, or the transition model, predicts next states, maybe probabilistically, and the reward function tells you, not next rewards, but just rewards. And so this is a model, jointly, and I already mentioned this, but we call methods that learn this quantity, learn these functions, and then use them to do decisions, model-based reinforcement learners. So how do we go from T and R to something like U?
Well, if we had those, if we had T and we had R and we could see the S's and the actions we took, then we could do something like the value iteration we did before to learn values.
Right, which value iteration was used to solve the Bellman equations.
Right.
So that is a somewhat heavyweight computation to do, but it's doable. So what happens over here is we actually have fairly direct learning. Why is that? Because when we're trying to learn the transition and reward function, we get state action pairs as input, and then we receive next state reward pairs as output. So we can solve this as a supervised learning problem.
Mm.
So learning is rather direct. The usage of this is a little bit computationally complex because you actually have to do the planning and then the optimizing to actually develop what the policy doesn't come directly out of that. But this kind of gives you a sense of three different ways, places that you can target the pieces of the MDP. So you can do reinforcement learning.
I like that.
Now, we're going to focus on this middle piece, partly because, you know, it's kind of the Goldilocks situation. It's, the learning's not so indirect and the usage is not so indirect. There's just been a tremendous amount of work focused on value function-based approaches. And it's, you know, remarkably simple, it turns out, if you do it right, and also very powerful, that there's lots of ways to use these simple ideas to learn hard problems. So I think this is a good place to focus.
Okay, I buy that.